There had long been rumors of oil in Long Beach. As far back as 1898, a well was sunk near Broadway and Redondo, but the technology gave out at 1,500 feet. Later, Union Oil drilled on Bixby land in 1917. They quit at 3,000 feet. Using the new rotary technology of the 20s, Shell Oil struck pay dirt on June 23, 1921, with its Alamitos No. 1 at Temple and Hill Streets.
We lived there at 4th and Newport, and the oil well that blew in was probably 2.5 miles away, and it sounded like 100 jets taking off. It blew in so hard that it caught on fire. There was just nothing but gas coming out of it. So my dad woke me up in the middle of the night, and I have no recollection of what time it was. I know it was night and I was asleep. And he says, the oil well blew in. Well, you could hear it very plainly, miles away. And so my dad and I walked up there. We got close to it. We couldn't have been more than 200 or 300 feet away at the closest. It was throwing rocks out just like a volcano. So there was a catering wagon there. It was horse-drawn. And we got under that wagon to keep from getting hit with all the rocks. And we stayed there for quite a while before it stopped throwing out rocks. That was the start of all the oil derricks on Signal Hill.
When they discovered oil, it's like a gold rush. Men came from all over, like my father coming from Texas, where he was working, and everybody had this dream of making money in Long Beach. And a number of people did.
It was such a boom day that they did things fast. We'd wake up in the morning and there'd be a new oil derrick in the horizon somewhere just about every morning. So it was a lot of action going on. They were putting in boiler plants and laying pipelines on top of the ground and digging ditches and building all kinds of buildings. And there was action, a lot of action.
We were drilling a lot of wells in them days. In the big boom, they used to drill in the middle of the road, pipelines every place. And we didn't know whose it was or whose it wasn't. If you wanted to put in a pipeline, put oil through it, well, go on. There's a well over there and there's a road over here, so come on, let's dig a ditch and put it in. We were going to town at that time. We'd put the big boilers in, start them up, build the derrick, drill the well, put the tubes down the hole, put the pumps down the hole, try to get the well going. Then we'd move out again to another place. Pipe was coming in by the carload. It was a madhouse, but we got through it all right. Oil was coming in them days, flying over the top. We had a lot of it. They were drilling number 6, just north of Burnett Street, and they got into a good zone called the Lovelady Pool. Then they put in a swab, a suction line to try to bring the well in. When they pulled the swab, gas was coming faster than they could get out. The gas went right over the derrick and oil was coming down like rain. Well, the old lady on the corner had a lot of white leghorn chickens and oil painted every one of them black. They had a lot of trouble trying to cut the thing off. Anyhow, they got it under control and boy, that made a lot of oil, 2,000 barrels a day. Tom Jenkin, foreman, DBM Oil.
But when they struck oil in Signal Hill, they needed a foreman down here, and they had picked my father's boss, but a day or two before he was to come to Signal Hill, he got caught stealing a spare tire off of one of their vehicles. So they chose my dad instead, and all of a sudden, my dad was a foreman for this Ventura company, which was later bought out by California Petroleum, which was finally bought out by Texaco. We moved in, when we moved in to Signal Hill, the houses we moved into, which were being built for the employees, I believe they were built by California Petroleum.
And at 21, he heard about the fact that Long Beach had a big oil boom on Signal Hill. And he immediately, he and one of his friends came out to California to work in the oil field, in which he found a job on Signal Hill. And he was here during the real big boom period from 1920 through to 1926. And he thought he had found heaven on earth. He lived in what he thought was a luxury hotel in a resort city on the beach. And at that time, there was a streetcar that came all the way up, and he could take that streetcar to work on Signal Hill.
It wasn't long. All these drillers and roustabouts came into town, and they made good money, what we considered very good money for those days. So he got all the business from the oil men, and he knew them. He knew most of the oil men right from the very beginning as they gradually expanded over Signal Hill. And I, as a kid, I used to like to sit in his barber shop there. I was about 8 years old and listen to the tall tales of the oil, the drillers and the roustabouts. And they were a pretty rough gang. So my dad had a sign there, 25 cents if you're caught swearing. it was amusing to me. And it's amazing how much money he collected from that little sign there.
Well, the Gushers were pretty much, I wouldn't say they were an everyday affair, but thinking back, it seems like there would be a Gusher just about once every two or three weeks that would affect us personally. It would get all over our cars and my mother's washing and be on the dogs and cats, and it was just a kind of a general nuisance. There was a gas engine that drove the pumping unit on the oil well that was closest to my house. That gas engine had to be no more than 50 feet from the bed I was sleeping in those days. And those gas engines had a peculiar sound to them that I'll never forget. I still hear them in my sleep sometimes, but you grow up with them, they didn't bother us, they just put us to sleep. They would go 24 hours a day. And when we lived there on that lease, then they were building these oil wells, and they were bringing these wells in, the gushers and things. My mother would hang a wash clothes and hang them out on the line, and then an oil well would blow in and the oil would get all over the clothes. And needless to say, she was pretty disgusted about it.
In imminent peril that permitted of no delay, the residents of Signal Hill routed from their homes yesterday by the blowout in General Petroleum's Black and Drake Well No. 1, fled through the rain of greasy crude oil, leaving behind everything but the clothing that they were wearing in many instances. The experience of H.B. Dobbins, a president of Dobbins Footwear Incorporated, and his family were typical of the banishment of several families. They piled hastily into their automobile and drove to safety, finding difficulty in getting through the oil that coated everything. They were almost drenched in getting out and sought shelter with friends or relatives. The Dobbins home is at Crescent and Hermosa. The roaring blast of the gas explosion awakened them yesterday morning. Then, about noon, the wind shifted and oil began to patter on their roof. It was so sudden that they fled like the residents of Pompeii before the streams of lava, without time for anything but flight. The home was white, now it is black. 200 trees in the orchard are lost. A great shade tree has been stripped of its branches by the clinging oil. The contents of their home are worthless, and the building soaked with highly inflammable oil, making it a fire trap in which no one may live. Long Beach Press, January 1922.
He was an oil well driller, and what they would do is they would work 12 hours on, 12 hours off, and they would work until the end of the job. And that being that if it took him 60 or 90 days to drill one of these wells, the wells were fairly shallow, they were less than 4,000 feet, they would work that entire time, and then they would take a couple of days off and start in again, 12 hours a day, 7 days a week. During that time, I don't know what the pay scale was in 1921. I know during the Depression that drillers were making $300 to $500 a month.
They would start building a wooden derrick one morning, and by the next afternoon, that derrick would be finished. And these rig builders were guys, they were like monkeys going up the side of those oil wells, and you could see those big boards going up with a block and tackle some way. I don't remember, just they had a block and tackle some way. They'd take a board up the side of the part that was already constructed, and those guys would nail those big boards on and hang out off of that oil well. I guess there were a lot of people killed.
Oil soon became a political football in Long Beach. To protect homes and businesses, citizens demanded a ban on oil drilling within the city limits. The ban was passed, but when they realized how much money there was to be made in oil, drilling zones were set up on the fringes of Long Beach. Every time the council would meet, the oil drilling boundaries would change. In 1923, the city council passed a tax of $1,000 on every well, which the oil men called highway robbery.
Soon after, Signal Hill decided to incorporate on their own. Long Beach had been trying to annex Signal Hill for a number of years, but when it became apparent Long Beach was going to tax oil, residents of Signal Hill, which were only about 800 people at the time, incorporated as their own city on the fundamental principle there would be no oil tax, which there's never been.
Long Beach was a quiet, staid place with its large proportion of retired Middle Westerners until it struck oil. Now, the streets are filled with great throngs of people. The traffic is dense, and groups stand on every street corner discussing oil and real estate. In banks, long lines of retired farmers with market baskets on arm wait their turn to see the officials who cannot take the time to interview customers in their offices, but only through windows. The crowds are strangely mixed. Elderly retired farmers, tourists, slick real estate and oil salesmen, and the khaki-clad oil operators and workmen. Real estate has been a phenomenal boom, and tall buildings are going up with the same feverish activity that marks the oil development itself. The Saturday Evening Post, July 1923.
My dad sold a property, and they gave him a lot for his commission. He was in the real estate business. He never went and looked at the lot, and somebody called him up on the phone or something and said, I'll give you twice what you got in that lot. And my dad said, okay, I'll sell it. Well, so he sold it, and then he went over and looked at the lot, and there was oil wells on both sides of it. So he kind of goofed up there.
A promoter came to me and said he would get action, and of course, action is what the landowner wants. The oil business is largely a gamble on men, and I was willing to gamble on this one. I thought by a bold stroke he might put it over, and he has. He told me he would go down like a greyhound, that he was a wolf on oil, and he has proved his statements. I was surrounded by three big companies, and the geologist told me that he would drain away my oil. But my man got down five wells on 9 acres so quickly that we, instead of the big companies, have got the oil.
My dad bought a lease up on Signal Hill, and he was bragging about it to his customers. And of course, the customers all wanted to come in with him. And Shell Oil developed with four derricks. And the first derrick came in 5,000 barrels a day. Tremendous amount. Of course, oil then was only about $1 a barrel. And so in the meantime, my dad had let 21 other men come in with him. I should be a millionaire from all the money he was supposed to make, but it was divided up 21 ways. And he had that lease for a good many years. And it was quite interesting to listen to the troubles that the oil man had. And it was dangerous work.
We had lots of fires. There were a lot of fires in Signal Hill in the 20s. All those wooden derricks and all the oil that was around was just a natural. There was gas, there was oil, and there was wood, there was lumber, and no safety rules, no OSHA. And there were a lot of accidents. And a lot of, I remember all the different oil companies had their own fire engines, and it was kind of like a co-op. They would, when there was a fire, they would all go together and help each other out. But fires were the big thing in those days. These were absorption plants, but we used to call them refineries, but one of those blew up in 1934, which was just a year after the 1933 earthquake in Long Beach. And actually that explosion caused more damage in and around Signal Hill where I live than the earthquake did. It was really a tremendous explosion and affected a lot of the people in Signal Hill.
As it turned out, the biggest single landowner in the oil zone was the city of Long Beach. Just by luck in the teens, they had bought 130 acres of land on the east side of Signal Hill called Reservoir Hill near Redondo to put water tanks in and so that the water would run downhill to the residents. Then when oil was struck, they realized that they owned land that had a lot of oil on it. And eventually the city put out bids and that land was drilled. And in fact, in the first month, the royalties covered more than the city had paid for the land. And then the hue and cry went up all over Long Beach that Long Beach was soon to be the only taxless city in America, that there would be enough money from oil revenues that Long Beach residents would never have to pay a tax again. And there were many articles and letters to the editor about the taxless city. What happened to all the money, we're not sure. But all through the 20s, oil revenues did pay one-third of the Long Beach budget.
Long Beach Cemetery Association and knew that they were sitting on top of an oil field, but of course they couldn't drill on their own properties there where the graves were located. So various enterprising promoters and operators made arrangements to obtain a lease on a piece of property just outside the oil-bearing area and slant drill underneath the cemetery, paying the cemetery association royalties. And this was a legal operation. But other people would take a lease next to them and either drill illegally under the cemetery or slant their drill up underneath the Union Oil Company Long Beach community lease. Now all of this, of course, didn't sit too well with the major operators on Signal Hill. The hot spot of this illegal operation lay just west of Cherry Avenue and south of Willow Street. This was the hot spot, or as it was also dubbed, Hell's Half Acre, and it was a frenzied scene indeed. These wells that were illegally drilled on the edge of the field in areas which had been condemned as being non-productive suddenly began coming in. Now, no miracle had occurred, and the major oil companies knew that these wells were drilled underneath the major oil companies' leases. But how to prove it? In the meantime, the wells kept coming in, fine big wells, 300 barrels a day, 500 barrels a day, 800 barrels a day, some as much as 1,000 barrels a day. They were drilled on a shoestring. Operators with very little money, with only $2,000 or $3,000 of so-called front money, would hire drilling crews for $1 a day cash and $6 a day out of oil, or they would issue royalty certificates to their drilling crews in fractional percentages, 0.25%, 0.5%, 0.5%, and the drilling crews sold these fractional interest to investors or speculators or other promoters, and there was a large underground business being operated at that time, selling and trading these percentages. Eventually, of course, the end purchaser of the percentage units lost when the wells were shut down, as they were. But for a while, it seemed as if everyone was making money. The promoters were making money, the suppliers of oil well equipment were making money, many of the oil well equipment people took percentages or fractions of percents in these illegal wells, winked at the illegal activities, said and quoted such platitudes as oil is where you find it, or oil is a migratory substance and you're perfectly free to chase after it. Nobody knows where the drill is, and nobody is going to find out, and so forth and so on. So, as I've said, the percentages were traded back and forth. Many, many of them sold on the Los Angeles and Long Beach stock exchanges, and even the stock exchanges as far distant as New York City, where the prices were grossly inflated because the name of Signal Hill was a magic name, and it was considered to be a chance of a lifetime to buy a royalty percentage or two in a Signal Hill producing oil well. Percentage units which actually were worth only about $500 a piece in Long Beach would be sold for as high as $2,000 or $3,000 in New York City. It was really a shame. A great, great many people, innocent purchasers of these percents, lost money. But in the meantime, the illegal wells were being drilled, and every manner of subterfuge was used to hide the fact that they were being drilled illegally, directed illegally. Even the direction was deliberately confused. These wells always seemed to be spudded in at midnight, and at some stage of the operation, a whipstock was inserted in the hole, or an elbow-jointed piece of drill pipe was put in, and off went the well in the direction the driller wanted it to go. But eventually, of course, the major oil companies, primarily Union Oil, got together, and these companies were able to get a court injunction against all of these wells drilled in the so-called Hell's Half Acre. They shut every single one of them down.
What happened at Signal Hill was unique in the history of oil. Oil is usually found out in the middle of nowhere. At Signal Hill, we had a major field discovered on the edge of the fastest growing city in America.
What happened in Long Beach was that because of the size of the oil field, and by the way, the Signal Hill oil field is the largest producing oil field in the world per acre. It's produced more oil than any other oil field in the world. And as a result, there was a lot of money to be made, and they started building high-rise buildings downtown Long Beach, and all kinds of things were built in the 20s that wouldn't have been built. If the city was strictly a resort and retirement community with a small harbor and a single shipyard. And so the oil business gave Long Beach its real growth. And a lot of people don't realize it. By 1940, Long Beach had a population of, I believe it was 160,000 people, which was more than the entire county of Orange. It was that prominent. And during that period of time, from the 20s up until after World War II, people from the farmers in Orange County would come to Long Beach for all their business because they had all the big stores and the fancy clothing stores and furniture stores and everything were in Long Beach. So Long Beach benefited, the oil here benefited all of Orange County, plus the money that it paid to the County of Los Angeles. It was a very, very important thing economically. And by the time this field was pretty well developed out, they found the big oil field in Huntington Beach, and then later they found an oil field in Dominguez Hills. And the result of that was that the oil tool company, the warehouses that were on Signal Hill became a regional businesses that all of these other oil fields used, the companies, the machine shops, and all of the other things. So this was pretty well in place up until into the 80s. So there was a period of almost 60 years where the oil well service companies and the oil well supply companies all had facilities in the Long Beach area.
After 85 years, the great field has yielded up a billion barrels of oil. And once again, Signal Hill has become a fashionable place to live. And Alamitos number one is still pumping. ¶¶